And likewise, we have to focus on the deja vu experience. How many of you had deja vu experiences that you can recall? When I say deja vu, I'm talking about the real deja vu experience. I'm not talking about, oh, I felt like I've been there before. No, I'm talking about knowing that you have been there before. All right, the only way you can possibly know something like this is some people have a dream and they magically remember it, or some people keep a dream journal. And then eventually they notice that whatever they saw in the dream comes true 100%. All right, so 100%. If it's raining in the background in the dream, it's still raining in reality. You're talking to the same people, and most of these people possibly you've never seen before. And there it's exactly, it's a complete replication of the dream. All right, my dad was into dream journaling, I'm gonna say, when I was little. He's a medical doctor. So when I was about 12 or 13, emulating my dad, I decided to keep a dream journal. And most of the dreams are nonsense, guys. It's gibberish. And then it's really tiring to wake up at the end of a dream and then jot down a few notes and then go back to sleep. And a lot of the stuff that you're watching or seeing in your dreams is complete utter nonsense. You may see a bull flying by over your car and taking a dump on it. So what do? You wake up and you jot down bullshit. And then in the morning, you try to reconstruct it. I mean, come on. Most of the dreams are like that. It's meaningless. And eventually, I noticed that this was complete nonsense. So I stopped doing it. Except for a few dreams, which became significant, evidently. One dream that I had when I was 14, I was in an apartment building, two-story building. I had a basketball in my hand. And then for whatever the reason, and I kept throwing it up against the wall, upstairs wall. And then the basketball would go up and then bounce back down. It would hit one of the stairs and it would just bounce in weird directions. And I would try to catch it. So I'm slamming the ball up against the wall, and then the ball is bouncing all over the place in this hallway. And then I'm making all this noise, and then boom, 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 the ball is going up and coming down, up and down. And I'm thinking, this is weird, because it's also dark at the same time. I was barely catching the ball. I thought that this was good for my reflexes. At some point I got hit in the face, and then that was a sobering experience because I didn't know which direction it was going. Ball was going, it was dark, and then I got hit. And then next thing I'm thinking, oh, I don't want to break anything in this building. Check to see if there's anything fragile. So I'm looking around, and I didn't see anything fragile, so I kept throwing the ball up against the wall, upstairs wall. And then one time the ball started to come down, and then it bounced at a really funny angle. It started to move towards the ceiling. When I was following the trajectory of the ball, I noticed that there was a light fixture on the way, right above me. So the ball makes contact with the light fixture, and next thing you know, the light fixture is coming down, seemingly in slow motion. It's just rotating and it's coming down. And then I thought to myself, I don't want to pay for this. So it seemed like it was in one piece. So why not just grab it and crazy glue it together? So I stuck my hand down. And then the next thought that I had, wait a minute, get your hand out of the way or else it's going to cut you open. My hand froze. This thing came down, hit the base of my hand. I was not able to catch it. Bounced up, went to the ground, and shattered to a million pieces. And at that point, I looked down and I saw something weird. At the base of my hand was cut to the bone. There was no pain. There was no blood initially. I could see my bone, and it was white and shiny. And I thought to myself, look at that bone. How white it is. How shiny it is. And I thought that was funny because I don't even brush it down. That was the extent of it. Anyway, so 10 years later, I'm in Norfolk, Virginia. This is the Old Dominion University. I'm 23 years old. I'm a second-year graduate student in a PhD program. And for those of you guys who don't know, guys, getting a PhD in physics requires that you pass something called the qualifiers, PhD qualifiers. They test you on 5 different topics, and each and every single test is about 4 hours long. All right. And you take this test as a second year graduate student. It takes about a year to get ready for this test. And then each and every single topic, the books are about this stuff. You're responsible to know that stuff inside out. All right. The tests take usually about 2.5 days. So you show up the first 4 hours. There's one test. There's a lunch break. You go back. You take the second test. The following day, you're off. You go back the third day, the following day, off. And Friday, half a day, you finish it up. And you have to pass each and every single test. If you flunk one of the tests, you flunk everything. And then they give you one more attempt the following year. And if you pass, you're in. If you fail, you're out. You get dismissed from the college, university, or whatever. So this was my second attempt, just like everyone else. All right, so all of us were on the same boat. This was our second attempt. And the guy upstairs was a physics student, and this was his second attempt as well. So we decided that just before the qualifiers, we should just do something fun every single day just to break the tension so we can focus better. We decided that we were going to play basketball. Anyway, so I had the basketball that day. So I came out. I know this guy is living upstairs. So I didn't want to bother to go upstairs and knock at the door. And I knew we were the only ones in the building at the time because this was afternoon, early afternoon. I yelled out his name. He didn't answer. So I decided to slam the ball up against his wall. Okay, so the entire building shook. He didn't come out. And the ball bounced at a really weird angle. So I thought, hey, this is a good way to warm up for the game because the ball was bouncing all over the place. It was rather random. So I kept throwing the ball. So I'm slamming the ball against his wall. He's not coming out. Boom, boom, boom. A couple of minutes later, I got hit in the face. And it was exactly the same as the dream, 100%. Everything was identical at that point. not after myself, oh, I don't want to break anything. So I checked to see if there was anything fragile. Because I was living in that building. I didn't want to break something and pay for it. That was the whole idea. I didn't see anything that was fragile. So I kept throwing the ball. And just like in the dream, the ball just took off towards the ceiling. At that point, I noticed that there was a light fixture and I was right down below it. So the ball made contact. Next thing you know, the light fixture is coming down. That was exactly the same. I stuck my hand out thinking that I should catch it and crazy glue it together. And then the second thought, just like in the dream, idiot, get your hand out of the way. You're about to cut yourself open. And next thing you know, the light fixture comes down, hits the base of my hand, and goes down to the floor and shattered to a million pieces. I looked down, and my hand was cut to the bone. It was weird. I had to go to an emergency room to get things stitched up. And I ended up getting about 5 stitches because of it. And that event saved my life because my hand was so badly cut, I was not able to take the qualifiers the following week. And every single person who took the test ended up failing it, including the guy upstairs. All right, all of them got dismissed from the university. And then along the way, the physics department realized that their tests were not fair, so they decided the difficulty of the test the following year, and then I was able to pass it like most people did, and things worked out. It was weird, all right? So what was so weird about it was the dream and the reality were 100% identical, despite the fact that they were 10 years apart. All right, so the question is, what do we make of it? So, it's the desk sport debut.
Let's do a little test right now.
Can we sense the future? All right, so the next documentary that you will watch is going to be related to this.
Everyone here, everyone in the studio is right here.
If Einstein is correct, the future must be happening.
Who came to see me?
It's like the present.
Me on my show. I want you to concentrate.
So, if that's the case, is it possible to actually sense the future?
Wait on me and think of a famous person, okay? Don't tell me who it is. Just look at me. Think of a famous person. Is it me? Wow. Did anyone else just get chills? And it appears I am not alone in possessing senses beyond sight, hearing, and the other ones. According to a study by Cornell psychology professor Daryl Bem, soon to be published in the Journal of Personality and Social Psychology, there is, quote, strong evidence for extrasensory perception, the ability to sense future events. I know you're thinking, Stephen, that's bullshit. But on the other hand, I know you're thinking, Stephen, that's bullshit. In his latest study, Professor Bem paid 100 college students $5 each to sit in front of a computer screen that displayed 2 curtains. They were told an image would appear behind one of the curtains and asked to predict which one. It's just like your grandfather's old game, which hand is hiding the quarter, except in this case, grandpa gets tenure. Now, when the image was neutral, subjects were able to predict which side it would appear on 49.8% of the time, statistically random. When the images about to be revealed were erotic in nature, participants were able to predict the correct side 53.1% of the time. Apparently, when it comes to seeing the future, we like to watch. Professor Bem suggests that subjects were able to sense the smut thanks to something called retroactive influence, meaning the pleasure of looking at naughty photos is so great, it ripples backwards from the future to influence us in the present. Powerful stuff. I just wish Professor Bem were here to explain it to me. Wait, I'm sensing a presence. Yes, joining me now, Professor Daryl Bem. Professor, thank you so much. Professor, thank you for going to have spoken to me. You will have been a great guest. Now, how is this working? How is this working that these waves of influence are coming from the future to show us the naughty parts?
We have no idea.
Thank you so much for joining us. What made you think to even try this? Did you just have college students and you thought, what can I show them that would raise eyebrows?
No, the belief that the future can be detected, it goes all the way back to the Old Testament.
Well, of course.
And about 60% of Americans believe that there are people who can do this.
Right.
And most psychologists say it's nonsense, like Ray Hyman.
Right.
And so it intrigued me to show in the laboratory whether we could actually find it in just unselected people.
But did you really show anything? It's 53%. That's not that big of a difference from 50%. How do you know you're actually demonstrating something with that?
Well, 53% sounds small.
Yes.
But that's exactly the amount that a casino has over you in a roulette wheel.
It's a 53% advantage.
Yes. Over you win 47% of the time, and they win 53% of the time at a roulette wheel. 53% is what Obama won over McCain in the presidential election.
Wait a second. Are you saying that Obama is a time-traveling pornographer? That's why he won't show us the birth certificate.
Perhaps.
Because the date is from the future.
Right. What it tells us is people didn't just go into the booth and flip a coin, because that 53% is actually quite large. It's also the size of the Colbert bump. Candidates who appear on this program have a 3% advantage over those who do not.
Really?
Yes. So 3% is...
3% is the Colbert bump? And you show me some pornography, it might get bigger.
That's right.
Now, But I got to ask, why did you say I'll show pornography? I still haven't figured out why not something else like interesting, like food? Why did you show pornography?
It's based on previous experiments by other researchers who show that if you are showing people pictures, they just sit there and watch them and measure their physiology with the lie detecting kind of equipment, that their arousal, not sexual arousal necessarily, but just arousal of the physiology, obviously goes up when they see a pornographic picture. Mm-hmm. But the amazing thing is it goes up 2 to 10 seconds before the picture appears, before the computer has even decided whether it's going to be a pornographic picture or not.
In your experiment?
No, that was the one that preceded it. That's why I decided to do
it. So your body would know that porn was coming?
Yes.
Before it actually appeared on the screen?
Evolutionarily, that would be wonderful.
So why do you think this is happening? If you had a theory, what would you say it is?
Actually, the theory we're working toward is quantum physics. Your next guest.
Brian Greene.
Yes. And anyone who's lived through the 20th century as a physicist is accustomed to seeing phenomena that are just as weird as the phenomenon I'm showing, but people are more interested in porn. It doesn't require as much mathematics.
Doctor, thank you so much for joining us. Cornell professor, Dr. Daryl Bem.
All right, guys, so this is the static universe, the black universe that Einstein was talking about, the way the destiny rules the free will is an illusion. And what we discussed so far is how the supporting evidence. Supporting evidence does not prove anything. There's something out there that you can refer to if this is what you want to believe in. So the psychic experiences, if you are a believer in that sort of stuff, obviously you do believe in a black universe. Deja vu experiences, once again, if you're a believer, obviously you believe in Einstein's static universe. Time traveling porn that you guys have seen is based on real research that you will get to watch over the weekend, so that's going to be your next assignment, along with the movie Sliding Doors. All right, so today's movie is Knowing. All right, so let's discuss that a little bit.
You and me together forever.
The theory of randomness says it's all simply coincidence. There is no grand meaning. Make it impossible for you to be sitting here in this riveting lecture.
50 years ago, the students of William Dawes Elementary imagined what the future might hold. Today, we unveil their legacy.
Okay, why are you showing me this? It's a list of dates. Every major global disaster for the last 50 years in perfect sequence. A piece of paper that's been buried in the ground for 5 decades. The next number on the chain predicts that tomorrow, 81 people are going to die in some kind of tragedy.
Get off the train.
Why? What's wrong?
Just take the baby and get off the train.
Estimates put the presumed dead at 81.
The prediction came true. It's not coincidence. Don't let him watch the news.
Why won't you tell me what's going on? They were here.
Who?
The Lucifer people.
What do you want with my son?
The numbers are a warning. They're a warning to everyone.
This is not a test. This is an emergency broadcast transmission.
We're going to stay on the air for as long as possible.
Are we going to die?
I will never let that happen, Caleb. Do you hear me? Never.